إن الحمد لله، نحمده تعالى ونستعينه ونستغفره، ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا. إنه من يهده الله فلا مضل له، ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته، ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون. يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة، وخلق منها زوجها، وبث منهما رجالًا كثيرًا ونساءً، واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام، إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا، يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم، ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما. أما بعد، فإن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله، وأحسن الهدى هدى محمدٍ صلى الله عليه وسلم، وشر الأمور محدثاتها، وكل محدثة بدعة، وكل بدعة ضلالة، وكل ضلالة في النار. وما قل وكفى خير مما كثر وألهى، وإنما توعدون لآت وما أنتم بمعجزين. ثم أما بعد، أيها المسلمون عباد الله، my brothers and sisters in Islam, it is reported in Sahih al-Bukhari and Muslim, and narrated by Abu Huraira radiallahu anhu, that Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, بدأ الإسلام غريباً وسيعود غريباً كما بدأ فطوبى للغرباء. In other narrations, the Prophet said alayhi salatu wassalam to those who asked him, Who are they? من الغرباء يا رسول الله؟ قال الذين يصلحون إذا فسد الناس. وفي رواية الذين يصلحون ما أفسد الناس. وفي رواية هم النزاع من القبائل. وفي رواية هم أناس من الخيرين بين أناس من أهل السوء كثيرين، من يعصيهم أكثر مما يطيعهم. So in this hadith, our Prophet said عليه الصلاة والسلام, Islam started like a strange thing, as a stranger. And Islam will return to be stranger again at the end of time. So glad tidings to the strangers. So the companions asked Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, who are they? Who are they? What did you mean by the strangers? So Prophet Muhammad said sallallahu alaihi wasallam, those who live their life to fix the corruption that exists around them. The righteous people who will live a righteous life while they are living among corrupted society or living in a corrupted society. Their mission is to fix the society, is to guide the society. So those people, Prophet Muhammad said alayhi salatu wassalam, are the strangers. Glad tiding for them in the day of judgment. Glad tiding, the good life for them in the day of judgment. So there are the first period of the strangers, which has happened in the beginning of Islam in Mecca, and the life of the strangers today in our era. The features of the life of the strangers in the first period, in the Meccan period, the first feature that the society rejected them, rejected their practice, opposed them physically, started to go for confrontation with them, physical confrontation, started to torture them. We all knew the story of Bilal ibn Rabah, who was taken by Umayyah ibn Khalaf and put under the heat of the sun, half naked. They put a heavy rock on his chest. They wanted him to do one thing, just to revert to the idol worshipping, to leave Islam or to curse Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But he did not say other than ahadun ahad. Khabbab ibn al-Arat, if you see his body, you will see holes in his body. They used to burn his skin to leave Islam. One family, the family of Yasir. Yasir himself got killed because he became Muslim. His wife Sumayya got killed because she was Muslima. Abdullah ibn Yasir got killed. Three people from one family. And they captured Ammar and tortured him to leave Islam. And he was patient until he was not able to take it anymore, so he cursed Prophet Muhammad sallallahu And then he went to the Prophet to tell him, O Messenger of Allah, they tortured me. I was not able to take it, so I destroyed myself. The Prophet said, وَمَا ذَاكَ? What is it? What did you do? He said, I cursed you, O Messenger of Allah. So the Prophet did not say anything until Allah Azza wa Jal revealed to him, إِلَّا مَنْ أُكْرِهُ وَقَلْبُهُ مُطْمَئِنٌّ بِالْإِيمَانِ. Except the one who is forced, but his heart is full of iman. So Ammar did not say what he said with free will. He was forced to say that. So he said it. So the Prophet said, if they torture you again, say it again. As long as your heart is full of iman. So the Muslims faced this. Quraysh tried their best to terrorize them. But they were not able to stop them. So they changed it. The tactic started to do something else. They started to call the Prophet names. The one who was the most truthful person became a liar. The most trustworthy, he became untrustworthy. They started to call him the magician. Started to fabricate rumors about his message and his teaching, to warn the people not to listen to him. But it didn't work out. So they started to change the tactic. They started to do something else. They said, how about to bargain with him? They started to offer him deals. They started to say to Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, how about to worship our gods for a year, and we worship your God for a year. So Allah Azza wa Jal answered him when he did reveal, قُلْ يَا أَيُّهَا الْكَافِرُونَ لَا أَعْبُدُ مَا تَعْبُدُونَ وَلَا أَنْتُمْ عَابِدُونَ مَا أَعْبُدُ. O unbelievers, I will never worship what you worship, and you will not worship what I am worshiping. The answer came from Allah Azza wa Jal. So they told the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, what you want? If you want to be the leader, we will make you the leader of us. If you want to be rich, we will collect the money and make you the most rich of us. If you want women, we will choose for you the most beautiful women we have in our society and give them to you. So what you want? But Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam did not accept any of that. He stayed upright, obeying his Lord, conveying the message of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, focusing on building the iman in his followers' hearts, building the correct creed in the hearts of his companions sallallahu alaihi wasallam. His mission was to make people know Allah Azza wa Jal, not only believe that there is a God. No, he wanted them to live the togetherness with Allah Azza wa Jal, to be real Muslims, to be righteous people, to live La ilaha illallah as a methodology of life. So every and each one of them, when he believed that Allah is all seeing, he knows that Allah is watching him all the time, 24/7. He cannot hide. When one of them believed that Allah is all hearing, so he does not utter except what pleases Allah. Even if he said something wrong, he comes to report himself by himself. The way Ammar ibn Yasir did. When they believe that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is all-knowing, so they cannot hide anything from him subhanahu wa ta'ala. So they lived la ilaha illallah. They lived the righteousness of Islam. Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam built the correct creed in their heart, taught them to be patient. Patient when they are learning the deen. Patient when they are implementing the deen. Patience when they are conveying the message to others and loving for others what they love for themselves. Patience when they face the reaction of the tyrants. So they accepted to be strangers in their own city, in their own country, in their own land. Imagine yourself, you are living in your own city with your people. Where you were born, and then all of a sudden you feel that you are a stranger. You are a stranger, you does not belong. You do not belong to them anymore. But Muslims accepted that. Even when they were forced to leave the city of Mecca to Abyssinia, twice they did for the sake of Allah. Until Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam took all of them with him to Yathrib to establish their healthy society, because they belong only to Allah Azza wa Jal. They believe only in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Their life only to please Allah Azza wa Jal and to build their future, the real future, their life after death. They lived while they knew that their life on earth is just limited. It's not smart to live your life, to have a position and to be famous and to save money in bank, and to build a big house, and to drive a luxury car, and then you leave all that and go to your grave to be asked about Allah and His Messenger, that you never spend any time to think of them. This is a wake-up call, because we are living in the end of time. This is the end of time. Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that the ummah will live under his leadership until he dies sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and then the righteous leaders who will lead the ummah according to the way of the Prophet for 30 years, Abu Bakr and Umar and Uthman and Ali and Hassan, and then it will be an inherited kingdom, inherited position in a kingdom. The Prophet described that by saying, خَيْرٌ فِيهِ دَخَنْ. It is good, but it's not pure good. And then the Prophet spoke to us about the period when we are led by tyrants. الحكم الجبري العاد. When somebody comes to position by force and hold on to it, he doesn't want to give it up. And if you disobey him, he will show you what Quraysh showed Prophet Muhammad ﷺ and his companions. Then Prophet Muhammad said ﷺ that the Muslims will be led by righteous leaders according to his way, the way it was in the time of Abu Bakr and Umar and Uthman and Ali, and then he did not say anything else ﷺ. So we are at the end of time. We live in the period of al-hukm al-jabri, the forced leadership. And we are suffering from same things the companions suffered from. Go to the Muslim land. I'm not talking to you about non-Muslim land. Go to the Muslim land. You see how the righteous people are treated in Syria, in Tunisia, in Yemen, in Sudan, in Iraq, in Egypt, wherever you go. Go to India. You will see people are getting beaten up in the street, burned while they are alive, just because of their deen. Same thing. People are using the same tactic, confrontation, physical attack. What else? They also call in the Muslims names, radicals, extremists, terrorists. They fabricate rumors about the deen itself and the message of Allah Azza wa Jal to drive people away, warning people not to accept the Islam. They are doing the same thing. So we need to have the same solution. Is to strengthen our relationship with our Lord subhanahu wa ta'ala, to learn our deen, to live the togetherness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to have a good relationship with Allah, to remember Him all the time, to know that Allah has seen us, so we must behave. Allah hears us, so we must behave. Allah knows everything about us, so we cannot hide from Him. When we say La ilaha illallah, as we talk the talk, we must walk the walk and live La ilaha illallah in our life. Practice it, not to play games, because every ummah played games with Allah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala punished them in dunya before al-akhirah. Wallahi, those who used to think that they are smart and they can play games with Allah, they will be punished in dunya before al-akhirah. So it is very important to learn our deen and to be patient, because without patience we will never learn. It's very important to be patient to implement, because without patience we will not be able to implement. To wake up in the morning for Fajr, you need to be patient. To pray your sunnahs, to read your Quran, to sit down to recite the remembrance of Allah, to be a polite person and a person of good manners, to take only what is halal and to refrain from what is haram. You need to be patient. Without patience, you will never be able to do that. To convey the message and to be patient with people, to guide them, to love for them what you love for yourself, and to be patient when the reaction is bad. Even if you're going to lose your job, even if they're going to stop you in airport and bat you down and take you to a special treatment, be strong. Because if you are not, you will lose both. Dunya is nothing. Dunya is nothing, and our life in this dunya is very short. And all of a sudden, you will see the angels of death in front of you, and you will be taken to your grave, and you will never be able to take your luxury house or your luxury car. You will never be able to transfer your balance, your bank account with you. You will never be able to do that until you do it now, before death, when you transfer your money to Akhirah by spending your money for the sake of Allah, doing it from halal, spending it in halal, doing it to please Allah Azza wa Jal, spending it to please Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You give up everything to please Allah Azza wa Jal. وَمَنْ تَرَكَ شَيْئًا لِلَّهِ عَوَّضَهُ اللَّهُ خَيْرًا مِّنْهُ. Whoever gives something for the sake of Allah, Allah will replace it with something better. So if you live as a stranger, Allah Azza wa Jal will make you feel that you own this dunya. Wallahi, if you say I'm Muslim, even if I am Muslim by myself, I'm Muslim, I will live as Muslim even if I'm alone. I'm Muslim and I don't care what people will say. I'm Muslim until I meet with Allah who created me to live as Muslim and to die as Muslim. When you do that, Allah will make you feel that you own the earth and everything on it. Allah will make you feel the most rich. Allah will make you taste the sweetness of Iman. Your job is to keep practicing, learning and practicing the deen until you taste the sweetness of Iman. A lot of brothers, they pray and come and say, Shaykh, I get bored in the prayer. I read Quran, but I feel bored when I'm reading Quran. So why you are bored? Because your heart is not in it. You are doing it not from your heart. So you need to keep training yourself to soften your heart with the remembrance of Allah. Love Allah and His Messenger more than anything. And love people only for the sake of Allah. And hate to disobey Allah Azza wa Jal the way you hate to be in hellfire. If you do so, Allah will make you taste the sweetness of Iman. أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله العظيم لي ولكم فاستغفروا. الحمد لله وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله،
اللهم صلِّ وسلِّم وزِد وبارِك عليه وعلى آل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين، وعلى أصحابه وأحبابه، ومن استنَّ بسُنَّته واختفى أثره ودعا بدعوته إلى يوم الدين. My brothers and sisters in Islam, we are not living the life of the strangers the way our Muslim brothers are living it in the Muslim land. We are living it in different way. We have different challenges. So now we have our kids. They are raised in public schools mostly. They go to college surrounded by overwhelming majority of non-Muslims. They are taught by atheist professors. So they are creating doubts in their hearts about Islam, about Allah and His Messenger. So some of the kids, they come clearly straightforward to their parents and tell them, my parents, you are Muslims, I respect that. I'm not Muslim and you must respect me. And some of the kids, they are not able to say it. So they live the double faces life, double life. So he is Muslim with the Muslims, non-Muslims with the non-Muslims. So he practices hypocrisy. And some of them are guided and saved by Allah. Alhamdulillah, Rabbil Alameen. We have atheism rate in the Muslim community past 25%. 25% of the children of the Muslims, the Muslim kids, more than 25% are completely atheist. And they say it clearly. So because of the time, the solution of this is to educate them about the deen. It's very important for them to learn the deen and from authentic source. We need to let them hear the deen. Subhanallah, when you bring scholars and students of knowledge from overseas and they come here, there is a big gap. Because the immigrants, they have different speed. So they are not able to catch the kids. So we need the scholars born and raised in this society. Those who are able to speak English without accent, not like me. We need somebody to speak better. Somebody understand the society, understand the law of the land, the culture of this society, the mentality of the people, how to speak, how to present the aqidah of Islam, the creed, how to represent the sharia, the legislations, how to attract the kids. If you make a speech here in this masjid, invite the youth, none of them will come for me. But if you bring somebody born and raised in this country, he knows how to open their hearts, you will see the masjid backed. So our mission is to have generations of scholars to come to be able to carry the flag of da'wah in this land. That's why I came from New Jersey State to visit your masjid today. I wanted to tell you, push your kids to learn the deen. Ask them to go to fill up application in one of the online universities. Learn your deen. And support every Islamic university in this country. Support them, they will become better. So one day you will see the scholars who are giving fatwas are strong in knowledge and honest. Because unfortunately, we whether have people who are weak in knowledge or people who are strong in knowledge, but they don't have sincerity. They play with the deen. They make the halal haram and the haram halal. And they open their masajid for fatwa shopping. You can go and get whatever fatwa you want. They can make any major sin to you halal. Don't worry about it. So we need the person who has these two qualities. Allah said, "Inna khayra man istajarta al-qawi al-amin." The most qualified person to hire is the one who has strength in knowledge and trustworthiness. The one who will say the truth no matter what. The one who will put effort from his heart, not because you are paying him. He's doing it because he wants to please Allah, not because he's receiving salary. So in order to raise this generation, we need to support them. So speak to your son, tell him go. Even if you are learning in medical school, even if you want to be pharmacist, even if you are studying engineering, it's okay. have part-time in the Islamic school online. So when you have Saturday and Sunday, study. When you have afternoon, when you come back from college, study. Study your deen. Participate in da'wah. Guide your friends. Because نفسك إن لم تشغلها بالحق شغلتك بالباطل. If you are not busy doing something good, you will be busy doing something wrong. You cannot just be doing nothing. Everybody is doing something, whether it's good or bad. So keep your kids busy, learning their deen, participating and volunteering in the da'wah activities, and support the Islamic schools and universities for your kids to find institutions to help them to become strong and effective. So inshallah, Allah will remove the life of the strangers. Allah will remove it just with time until we go to the right and the final period of the life of the Muslims. خلافة على منهاج النبوة. When we go back and practice the deen the way it was practiced in the time of the Prophet. When we will have leaders just close to, I'm not going to say they will match, but close to the righteous predecessors, the companions of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Just close to. We can do it. We can go there, inshallah, tabaraka wa ta'ala. So my brothers and sisters, I came here as guest to speak to you about Mishkat University. Mishkat University is very well known here in Houston, especially because the base is here in Almira. And you have the president and the founder of this university, is Dr. Salah Al-Sawi, who is one of the top scholars of the Muslims in the world. And alhamdulillah, they have an online program to help the youth to learn their deen from strong teachers and to help them to understand how to represent their deen in society like this. So I'm asking you to support this university by asking your kids to sign their names as students, and you sign your name yourself, because there is no age limit. If you need to learn, go sign your own name, and in the same time support with money, because without support none of the Islamic institution will survive, because nobody is taking care of the masajid and the Islamic schools and the universities except you as Muslims, when you pay tuition or when you pay donation. Tuition or donation, without that there is no way for them to survive. So we need to be hand to hand building our institutions, helping our kids to be raised in this tough society, because you cannot bring them here to face the high waves of fitan and tribulations and temptations and leave them by themselves. We need to do the means. So we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to guide our hearts to obey Him and to submit to Him and to live as Muslims until we meet with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. اللهم اغفر لنا ذنوبنا أجمعين وهب المسيئين منا للمحسنين. اللهم اغفر لنا ذنوبنا أجمعين وهب المسيئين منا للمحسنين. اللهم إنا نسألك أن تردنا جميعا إلى دينك مردا جميلا. اللهم اجعلنا جميعا من عبادك الصالحين. اللهم اجعلنا جميعا من عبادك الصالحين. واغفر لنا ذنوبنا يا رب العالمين. اللهم اشرح صدورنا. اللهم طهر قلوبنا. اللهم احفظ فروجنا. اللهم إنا نسألك رضاك والجنة ونعوذ بك من سخطك والنار. اللهم أصلحنا وأزواجنا وأولادنا واجعلنا صالحين مصلحين. اللهم اهدنا ويسر الهدى لنا واهدي أزواجنا وأولادنا واجعلنا هداة مهتدين. اللهم اغفر لنا ولوالدينا يا رب العالمين، واجعل خير أعمالنا خواتيمها وخير أيامنا يوم لقائك. اللهم انصر عبادك المستضعفين في كل مكان. اللهم انصر عبادك المستضعفين في الهند وفي غزة وفي سوريا والعراق وفي ليبيا وفي اليمن وفي كل أرض يا رب العالمين. اللهم إنا نسألك أن تحقن دماء المسلمين في السودان. اللهم احقن دماء المسلمين في السودان. اللهم احقن دماء المسلمين في السودان ورد المسلمين إلى دينك مردا جميلا. سبحان ربك رب العزة عما يصفون وسلام على المرسلين والحمد لله رب العالمين. قوموا إلى صلاتكم يرحمكم الله. أقم الصلاة.